church exists on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabemowin, the Attawandaron, the Mississauga, and the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. We honor the original ancestors of this land and also offer respect to our Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, Mississauga, and Métis neighbors. We give thanks for the First Peoples and all who have cared for the land and made it possible for us to dwell and do ministry, and we commit ourselves to walk in right relations with one another. Today we acknowledge the sacred teaching of respect, to honor all creation, and to treat all creation as we would like to be treated. Good morning, happy Father's Day, and welcome to you all. Please rise in body for spirit and join me in the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider.
Help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take a faith to your teachings and your ways.
Turn again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us the life in the world. Amen.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Our gathering song is Spirit, Open My Heart. It's in the hymn book we don't have, but you should have received a handout of the hymn. And we practiced it a couple of weeks ago as well. Spirit, open my heart.
Thank you.
grace of Jesus Christ, God's child, the love of God, our mother, and the power of the Holy Spirit, breath of life, be with you all.
And also with you.
Kyrie.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Church of Corinth.
Glory to you, O God.
As Christ's co-workers, we beg you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For God says through Isaiah, "At the acceptable time I heard you, and on the day of salvation I helped you. Now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. We take pains to avoid giving offense to anyone, for we don't want our ministry to be blamed. Instead, in all that we do, we try to present ourselves as ministers of God, acting with patient endurance amid trials, difficulties, distresses, beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger. We conduct ourselves with innocence, knowledge, patience, and kindness in the Holy Spirit, in sincere love, with the message of truth and the power of God, wielding the weapons of justice with both right hand and left. Regardless of whether we are honored or dishonored, spoken of favorably or unfavorably, we are called imposters, yet we are truthful. We are called unknowns, yet we are famous. We are said to be dying, yet we are alive, punished, but not put to death. Sorrowful though we are always rejoicing, poor, yet we enrich many. We seem to have nothing, yet we possess everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. We've opened our hearts wide to you. We're not holding anything back. You, on the other hand, are holding back your affection from us. It would be a fair exchange. I speak as to my children. If you'd open your hearts as widely to us as we do to you. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God.
Same day, Jesus said to the disciples, "Let's cross over to the other shore." Leaving the crowd behind, they took Jesus in the boat in which he was sitting. There were other boats with them. Then a fierce gale arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so much that it was almost swamped. But Jesus was in the stern through it all, sound asleep on a cushion. They woke him and said, "Teacher, doesn't it matter to you that we're going to drown?" Jesus awoke, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, "Quiet, be calm." And the wind dropped and everything was perfectly calm. Jesus then said to the disciples, "Why were you so frightened? Have you no faith?" But they became filled with fear and said to one another, "Who is this whom even the wind and sea obey?" This is the good news of Jesus. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I have no children to come up, but we're going to show the Anishinaabe video. This week's teaching is respect.
Thousands of years ago, the first peoples of Turtle Island, North America, were given a gift from the Creator, the seven sacred laws. Elders continue to share these teachings in their sacred lodges today.
During the vision quest ceremony, a boy must spend time alone on the land, seeking a vision. He must be initiated by Mother Earth. In doing so, the boy has a path to manhood that is based on respect for women and all life on the earth. It was the fourth and final night. Tired, hungry, and anxious, he awaited the sunrise. As he lay in a light sleep close to the fire, a strange noise woke him. The boy quickly sat up and searched in all directions, but saw nothing. Then a deep voice came from the sacred fire.
My grandson, we have heard your call.
The boy turned to the flames and froze in disbelief as a large buffalo appeared.
Do not fear, for I bring you the first law of respect. I have given every part of myself to help the people to survive. Respect means giving from the heart without expecting anything in return. Now take this message, my boy, and share it with the people.
The buffalo stared deep into the boy's eyes, making a connection that spoke to his spirit before disappearing. Mashkote Bijike, the grandfather buffalo, stands on guard to remind us of the law of respect. Respect all life on Mother Earth. Respect the land. Respect your elders. Respect people of all colors. The boy couldn't believe what he had seen. He sat in silence, thinking of the teaching shared by the buffalo. Suddenly, he was startled by a high-pitched screech. He looked to the dark sky and saw a large creature flying towards him.
On that day, that very long day of teaching, learning, and explanation for those very, very new disciples, when evening had finally come and they were more than ready for some much-needed rest, Jesus says to them, "Let's row over to the other side." Jesus lies down and falls asleep in the back of the boat. Granted, Jesus has been doing most of the teaching, and at least four of the disciples are seasoned fishermen, so it's not surprising that they should be piloting the boat while Jesus catches 40 winks. It's really not that big of a deal until what only can be described as all hell breaks loose. A great windstorm arises out of nowhere. The rain is pelting their faces. They have to scream at one another to be heard over the wind. It's dark and they cannot see, but they sure can hear and feel the waves crashing into the boat. One rather large and unexpected wave quickly swamps the boat, and it looks like they're going to sink. Jesus, still sleeping soundly on the cushions in the back of the boat, seems oblivious to all of this. And that kind of seems strange to me. Here we have these new disciples. New disciples, and yet seasoned fishermen, experiencing what seems to be the storm of the century. The boat is being tossed about like a toy traversing whitewater rapids. The disciples are rushing about trying to steady the boat. Orders are being screamed from one end of the boat to the other, and Jesus rests peacefully. Finally, they shake him awake, and in fear, in anger, and in desperation, they shout, "Do you not care that we are perishing?" We, of course, know well what happens next. Jesus wakes up, rebukes the wind, and says to the sea, "Peace, be still." The winds stop, and there's dead calm. Now, approaching this story with a Sunday school understanding of Scripture, this is the gist of the story. It is a story of divine power. It tells us who Jesus is. It answers the disciples' question, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" It forces our minds back to the creation story, where with a word, God ordered the chaos of the primordial waters and created the world. This story was written by Mark to tell us that Jesus is God. But it is also much more than that. In fact, if we don't move beyond a Sunday school understanding and go deeper into the text, when Jesus says, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" it leaves us with nothing but a scolding for not having the faith that can move mountains. leaves us all scolded because none of us can move mountains. Where is the good news in that? Delving deeper, we can note Jesus never says that there's nothing to be afraid of. He only asks, why are you afraid? That is easy to answer because sometimes in life we are tossed about like that boat. Sometimes it seems as if God doesn't care that we are perishing here. What are we afraid of? The list is long. Isolation, pain, illness, rejection, job loss, failure, money problems, inadequacy, meaninglessness, and death. Death and separation from those we love. Every single one of us at many points in our lives are tossed about and find ourselves afraid. So is Jesus really equating fear with a lack of faith? We are going to encounter things that fill us with fear. It's inevitable. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that this story isn't about divine power and faith. It really is about those things. The story really forces us to notice the contrast of the faith of Jesus and the fear of the disciples. The faith of Jesus gives him great peace. It's a reminder that the fearsome things we encounter do not have the last word. They really carry no ultimate power over us. If anything, this story encourages us in our times of trouble to turn to the God of wind and wave, to call out to Jesus and ask him to care for us, to demand shelter and then guidance back to the shore. Theologian David Lose identifies a connection between fear and a lack of faith. He says, think of faith primarily as trust, not simply as belief, but as the kind of trust that motivates you into action. For example, you only let people you trust watch your kids when they're little. And if you lose trust in your employer, you find it hard to give all you've got to your job. Does that make sense? Faith is really trust. He goes on to say, when I'm afraid, I have a really, really hard time trusting. Fear paralyzes, making trust and the confident action that makes trust possible very difficult, if not impossible. So maybe it's not that the disciples are understandably afraid because of the storm. It's that they allowed their fear to overtake them so that they don't come to Jesus and say, hey, teacher, we need your help. Or rather, they come already assuming the worst. Teacher, don't you care that we're dying? This isn't a trusting or faithful request. It's a fear-induced accusation. Now remember, Jesus still calms the sea. He does care for them in spite of their accusation. They obviously don't have perfect faith, but God still responds, still looks out for them. They are now filled with anxiety at the presence and power of God among them. They thought they knew who Jesus was, but now realize they really did not. We too are invited to bring our fears and anxieties and concerns to God as best we can and watch as they are transformed, and transformed now. Paul recalls that the prophet Isaiah said, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. Paul says, see, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. Paul is pointing out that salvation is not just some future event. It's here and it's now. The word used here for time is not chronos or chronological time. It's kairos time, which is a time that is fit for something. It is the appointed time for God's purpose. The kingdom of God is at hand. God is breaking into the world. God's kairos time takes place at the intersection of two worlds or two realities. The old creation becomes the new creation. The first Adam becomes the last Adam. There is the world according to the flesh and the world according to the spirit. We live in sin, but are made righteous. We as the church, the people of God, live at that intersection. We don't always see it, but the kingdom of God exists in this world. So as you travel through the storms of life, look for God. Scream out for God. Get angry with God if that's what's needed. But look for God. Reach out to God. It is naive to think faith in God will alleviate our fears or eliminate storms that we find ourselves in. But still, God is there. With a word, God can show us that through Christ, nothing else, not even death, has ultimate power over us. I would like to close with the words from another of Paul's letters. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who did not withhold God's own Son, but gave him for all of us. Will God not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through God who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, not power, not height, not depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to rise again in body or spirit and join me in singing our hymn of the day, Almighty God, Your Word is Cast. It's number 516.
Janet and Pastor Steve, you have been chosen as delegates representing our Congregation of Trinity at the 2024 Eastern Synod Assembly. We give thanks that you will represent us at this historic gathering. We join with you in hopeful expectation that this time of worship, consultation, decision-making, and election of a new synod bishop and officers will be a faithful witness to the mission and ministry of our shared Christian faith, which we will affirm together now using the affirmation of faith on the screen. We believe in God the Creator, who loves the world and says it is good. We believe in Jesus Christ, the presence of God embodied and among us. Jesus walks with the lonely, eats with sinners, feeds the hungry, forgives the unforgivable, and continues to show us the way. He calls us to a life that death cannot end. We believe in the Holy Spirit of God, who has spoken through the prophets, and continues to urge us to live fully and honestly, seeking justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly as a forgiven and forgiving people whose joy gives life. We believe in the Church as community. Though flawed and imperfect, the Church offers a place for everyone. We believe that Christ is among us and leads us to give ourselves away in love. We believe we are called to choose hope, to resist evil, to advocate for the oppressed, and to rejoice in the gift of life. Amen.
You are sent to this gathering to serve the whole Church. Will you seek the guidance of God as you join others in making decisions for the Church? Will you bear the reconciliation of Christ as you work with others to determine the will of God for the future of the Church? Will you share the Holy Spirit's joy in worship and work together? If so, please say, yes, and I pray that God will help and direct me.
Yes, and I pray that God will help and direct me.
People of God, will you support these delegates in prayer? Will you pray for the Synod and Assembly as they make decisions for our life and ministry and the election of new officers? If so, please say, we will.
We will.
I invite you to extend your hands toward Pastor Steve and Janet in blessing. Janet and Pastor Steve, we bless you as you go in the name of God to serve us and all the people of God in the worship and work of this assembly. The light of Christ shines in you. The Spirit of Christ guides you. God bless your travel, this work, and your homecoming. Amen.
I ask you to rise for the prayers of the people. We come before the triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, and our world. Life-giving God, help us to have ears to listen. Give us the patience and the level-headedness to hear one another respectfully and wholeheartedly when we have differences, and to do our best to empathize with and understand where each other is coming from. God of balance,
teach us to be respectful like the buffalo.
Life-giving God, remind us to think of how our everyday actions impact others and put it on our hearts to ensure that our behavior is considerate of others and creation. Sustaining God. Sorry. God of balance. I should write down what I put on the screen. God of balance.
Teach us to be respectful like the buffalo.
Life-giving God, you have blessed us with so many gifts. Help us to honor these gifts through showing our respect toward creation and one another by being good stewards of your earth, caring for its creatures, and taking from it only what we need. God of balance.
Teach us to be respectful like the buffalo.
Life-giving God, remind us that no matter our race, ethnicity, cultural background, employment status, religion, sexuality, gender, age, or politics, we are all inherently human and deserve respect and care. God of balance,
teach us to be respectful and above love.
Life-giving God, tend to all who journey by faith and who wait with patience for the fulfillment of your healing promises. Grant perseverance to people doing physical and occupational therapy, people living with mobility concerns, and people facing chronic pain, as well all of those we lift before you now in the silence of our hearts. God of balance, life-giving God, remind us to honor ourselves with the same respect we would bestow unto others. As well, on this day, let us honor all the father figures in our lives. God of balance, life-giving God, you have spread your reign of love the world round. We pray for myself and Janet and all of the Eastern Synod staff and delegates as they attempt to partner with you in spreading that love. God of balance,
teach us to be respectful like the buffalo.
Grant us eyes to see your fingerprints in all of creation. Grace us with an awareness of your presence so that we might live with respect for all, giving dignity where it is due, and doing all as stewards of the mysteries you have entrusted to us through Christ our healer. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share a sign of that peace with one another. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word, you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith. Increase our hope. And deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Christ is with us, and so together we pray. Our Creator in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So just a couple of announcements today. The first one is that Shirley Weicker was laid to rest yesterday. So prayers for her family as they remember Shirley. The Eastern Synod Assembly begins on Thursday to Saturday. In case of a pastoral care emergency, there's no one on call, but I have my cell phone with me, so you can always call me. If I don't answer right away, just leave a message. Christine and Stephen, who are in church today, are being married this coming Friday. All of the preparations must be in place. You look very calm, and congratulations to you all, and I'll see you on Friday. But let's see. And the only other announcements I have is the tickets are on sale for the Christmas in July meal on July the 16th. So you still have lots of time, but get your tickets so that they can plan the right number of turkey dinners. Are there any other announcements? Seeing none, receive God's blessing. The God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus.
Amen.
The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The God of all grace bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Our sending hymn is appropriate for Father's Day. This is My Father's World. It's number 824. 824.